Hello, my name is Pedro Can, and I'm very happy to be part of this Sao Paulo HIV Clinical Forum 2020 organized by Virology Education. This activity is directed by Jonathan Shapiro and Charles Boucher, the very good known scientist and good friend of mine. You will see here my disclosures. And let's start by showing you that we have in the current regimens highly active antiretroviral therapy, a very high efficacy. As you can see in the screen, most of the most recent studies showed an efficacy above 90%, 92, 93, even eventually 94%. So the question is, how far beyond that can we go with new drugs? It's unthinkable that we will reach 100%. Just for the sake of comparison, look at the little box that is below the dotted line, and you will see that it shows the efficacy of efavirenz when it was launched based on the 06 study. It was about 56% of efficacy. So really, it's a major achievement that we had with the latest protocols that gave us the new drugs that we are using now. In this slide, I'm showing you why, if everything is okay, why are we trying to reduce the drug burden? First of all, our population is aging. Not only doctors, but also patients are aging. We try to reduce antiretroviral exposure, making treatment safer without sacrificing virological potency. We want to reduce pill burden and improve patients' adherence and improve their quality of life. Also to reduce the risk of drug-drug interactions, eventually, if we can, to reduce costs and preserve a potential for long-term success, having downstream options with classes that we are not using in dual therapy in case if this regimen would fail. Here is an interesting poll that was performed over 1,000 patients, and you can see that almost three quarters of the patients were worried about taking long-term antiretroviral therapy. They were mainly concerned about long-term effects, and they would like to have longer treatment intervals, which is a very interesting issue that is coming in the next future. So the question that we posed when we started thinking about dual therapy was, is heart about the number of drugs or is it about potency and safety? And the rationale was that heart is a lifelong treatment. For instance, if you diagnose a patient in his 20s, this patient has a life expectancy of 50 or 60 years, so he will be exposed for 50 or 60 years to antiretroviral therapy. We know that the current regimens have high efficacy. There have been other attempts to simplify heart, for instance, with monotherapy, but monotherapy failed to show non-inferiority in antiretroviral naive patients. And based on the data that monotherapy failed, but was very close to show non-inferiority, we said, what about if we add 3TC, which is the most frequently prescribed antiretroviral in the last 30 years, is a generic drug, cheap, extremely well tolerated, and even still active in presence of the M184B signatory mutation. So the first study that we performed, that was the first randomized clinical trial with enough potency to show non-inferiority, was the Gardel study. In this study, we compared lopinavir ritonavir plus 3TC against lopinavir ritonavir plus 2 nucleosides. And as you can see, both at 48 weeks and at 96 weeks in the red line, the dual therapy regimen was non-inferior to the triple therapy comparison arm. Most important than that is what I'm showing you here, is that patients with more than 100,000 copies, the results were exactly the same. So even in people with high viral load, this combination worked. The problem is that lopinavir ritonavir is 4 tablets a day, a lot of drug-drug interactions, side effects, etc. So we decided to test this strategy with darunavir ritonavir. So we did the ANDE study, and as you can see here in the graph, in the bar graph, both for the totality of the patients and also for the patients with more than 100,000 copies, non-inferiority was shown. So the concept was proven. So the next step was to say, okay, what can we do beyond that? Can we do that with boosted PIs? We showed that we can. So what about dolutegravir, which is a drug that has a high genetic variant? So we designed the PADL study, that was a very carefully designed 20 patient study with two cohorts of consecutive cohort of 10 patients each. Everybody had to have less than 100,000 copies at screening, but as you can see in the third column, four patients marked in red that had more than 100,000 copies at baseline. And what you see in green, in the boxes in green, are patients with less than 400 copies, and in yellow, patients with less than 50 copies. So, as you can see, by week four, everybody had less than 400 copies, and by week eight, everybody was below 50 copies. At the end of the study, at week 96, 18 out of 20 patients persisted with undetectable viral load. We had two cases that didn't make it. One was a patient that died before, and he had viral load less than 50 at the moment he passed away. And we had a case of protocol-defined virological failure, a patient that had two consecutive viral loads above 50 copies, but below 400. And as per protocol, the patient was considered a failure, but eventually he resuppressed with the same regime, the dolutegravir 3TC, improving adherence. Based on our results, the ACE clinical trial group, the ACTC 5353 trial, was designed, including 120 patients instead of 20, and having a cap of 500,000 copies instead of 100,000 copies as we did. And as you can see, 89% and 90% respectively, below and above 100,000 copies, achieved a virological success. The intriguing question was what you see in the bottom of the slide, in which three patients had protocol-defined virological failure, but one patient had emergent resistance for 3TC and minor resistant mutation for dolutegravir, the 263CRK. I call it minor, eventually it is an important mutation, but it seems to affect the virological replicative capacity of the virus. So the impact of this mutation is a matter of debate. So then we thought that we have to pose a lot of questions regarding the issue of using dolutegravir 3TC in treatment-naive patients. Would this regimen be durable? Would it be efficacious in patients with high viral load and low CD4s? What about more sensitive viral markers like target non-detected, frequency of blips, rate and time to virological suppression, barrier to resistance, and safety and tolerability? So we designed the Gemini 1 and Gemini 2, and what I'm showing you here is the results by week 144. This was a clinical, there were two different clinical trials, Gemini 1 and Gemini 2. Here I'm showing the pool population, intention to treat. And as you can see, at week 24, 48, 96, and 144, this study of about 1,400 patients showed non-inferiority for the dual therapy strategy. And very important to show, at week 96, there was no emergent resistance in any case that had confirmed virological withdrawal. As you can see, numbers are very small, 4 and 5 in the dolutegravir 3TC arm at week 46 and 48 and 96. And 2 and 4 in the triple therapy arm for Gemini 1, and so on in the different Gemini 2 and pooled results. So this moved the FDA and the European agency to approve the combination of dolutegravir 3TC as an option for treating patients in first line. What I want to show in this quite busy slide is the bottom part. At week 144, we saw one patient in the dolutegravir 3TC arm who didn't reach the confirmed virological withdrawal endpoint. Why is that? Because confirmed virological withdrawal meant to have two consecutive viral load above 200 copies. The patient developed the M184B mutation at week 132 with a viral load of 61,000 copies, and at week 144, with a viral load of 135 copies, so the patient improved the adherence and dropped down viral load, but not to a detectable level, showed the R260CRK mutation. This resulted in 1.84 change in the dolutegravir susceptibility, and really this didn't affect the dolutegravir activity. So as you can see, the patient was resuppressed with dolutegravir once a day, under the runavir commences start after week 144. And this is the only case in more than 1,400 patients after 144 weeks that we saw with emergent resistance. So in regards to safety, there was a significant lower risk of drug-related adverse events with dolutegravir TTC, 20% versus 27%, with a relative risk of 0.76. Regarding weight gain, which is an interesting topic with the integrase inhibitors, you can see that the weight gain for dolutegravir TTC was 3.7 kilograms, and for the triple therapy arm was 2.4. And this is due to the effect of tenofovir difumarate that, as you know, in some way is buffering the weight gain effect that might emerge from the dolutegravir. This is not the case with tenofovir alafenamide, so be careful that don't think that tenofovir as a drug solves this problem. It's tenofovir difumarate, but not tenofovir alafenamide. Regarding the efficacy in different strata, you can see that below and above 100,000 copies, there's no difference between arms. Same happens with baseline CD4 above 200 cells, but in patients with less than 200 cells, there is a numerical difference. Two things to say here regarding this point. First, less than 9% of the patients were included with this low CD4 count, probably reflecting our current trend to treat everybody as soon as they are diagnosed. And second, the reasons for not being in window in the FDA snapshot analysis were not due to virological failure, but they were due to other reasons like incident tuberculosis, Chagas disease, patients moving to other cities, etc., administrative reasons. So there was not related to virological failure. And as a proof of that, you can see that neither in the DHHS guidelines, nor in the ISUSA guidelines or the European guidelines, the level of CD4 is a limitation to use this strategy in naive patients. So what about viral decay? You can see two curves here. In one curve, you can see the viral decay, and you see no difference between the dolutegravir TTC and the triple therapy. And in the other curve, you see the time to virological suppression. So again, the curves are superimposed and show that the viral decay is exactly the same with the two different strategies. And regarding blips, again, the same story. Eventually, numerically, you see more blips in the triple therapy arm, but the difference is not statistically significant. So again, the concept of non-inferiority regarding blips is again shown here. And what about target not detected? You might remember that when our virologists tell us about the viral load they are measuring, they tell us less than 50 copies, less than 40, less than 20, depending on the kit you're using. But they can also tell us if there is any signal detected. So target not detected means that no signal is available for the virologist to report to us. And as you can see, in patients with more than 100,000 copies, less than 100,000 copies, above 200 CD4 or below 200 CD4, there's no difference at week 96 between groups. So this is also reassuring. And regarding the laboratory markers, there is evident advantages for dolutegravir TTC in terms of plasma and urine renal biomarkers, for serum bone turnover biomarkers, but this is different with lipids. In lipids, there is a beneficial effect of tenofovir difumarate, again, not seen with tenofovir alafenamide, in which you can see that the decrease in total cholesterol, HDL, LDL cholesterol, etc., is higher with the triple therapy arm. But when you go to the bottom line of the first box, you can see that the total cholesterol to HDL cholesterol ratio is very similar and did not achieve statistical significance. So really the impact on lipids is minor. So I think I have addressed all the questions that I posed a couple of slides before. Durability, efficacy, sensitive viral markers, frequency of blips, rate and type of virological suppression, barrier to resistance, safety and tolerability. And another proof of this combination is the TANGO study. The TANGO study is a study in which patients were switched from a TAF-based regimen after 6 months of being undetectable. And the primary endpoint here is proportion of patients that have viral load at week 48 above 50 copies. And as you can see, 0.3 and 0.5% respectively, showing non-inferiority for this regimen as a switch strategy. Another strategy that has been pursued with dual therapy is the combination of dolutegravir and rilpivirine, in which patients were undetectable on an integrase inhibitor non-nucleoside or boosted PI regimen plus two nucleosides, and they were randomized 1-to-1, either to continue antiretroviral regimen in orange or in blue to go to dolutegravir rilpivirine. And after week 52, everybody went to dolutegravir rilpivirine regimen. And as you can see here, you don't need to be a statistician to understand that the non-inferiority has been achieved, 95% efficacy in terms of virological success, and non-virological response, less than 1% and 1% respectively. So really non-inferiority was also shown for this particular strategy. Regarding adverse events, 77% versus 71%, and really serious adverse events, 5% versus 4%. So really this strategy was pretty safe. Regarding confirmed virological withdrawals, only one subject in the dual therapy arm met the confirmed virological withdrawal criteria and had one mutation associated to rilpivirine, the K101, and no integrase inhibitor resistant mutations were identified. And other examples of dual therapy are shown here, the ATLAS and the FLAIR study. These are injectable cabotegravir and injectable rilpivirine, the ATLAS in switch situation, the FLAIR in naive patients, and in both cases, non-inferiority has been shown. So this is another confirmation of dual therapy efficacy, but in this case, instead of being oral, it's been injectable. And to show that this is not only a point of one company, this is a Merck study in which two drugs are used. Islatravir, which is a nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor, which is also a translation inhibitor, a very potent drug. Look at the numbers, 0.25, 0.75, 2.25 milligrams. They were tested in patients that started with a triple therapy regimen, islatravir, doravirine, and 3TC, and then the patients were switched either to continue with doravirine, 3TC, and tenofovir, or to use islatravir and doravirine at different doses, and even being a phase 2 trial, so we cannot claim non-inferiority, the results are very interesting. About 90% of the patients with the lower doses were undetectable at the end of the study. So coming to the end, I think we have reinforcing data to use the dolutegravir 3TC, rapid and potent antiviral activity, high barrier to resistance, due to the long binding that this drug has to the integrase inhibitor, to the integrase enzyme, low chances of DDIs, drug-drug interactions, long half-life, very, very good tolerability, and several trials proving the concept of dual therapy. So in conclusion, two drug ART regimens are challenging our current three drug ART regimens. So I think it's no longer the time to ask, why should I use two drugs? The question you should pose yourself is, why should I expose my patient to three drugs if I can do exactly the same work with two drugs? Optimal two drugs are potent, convenient, well-tolerated, and with high barrier to resistance. The strongest data are with dolutegravir and 3TC. I showed you also data with dolutegravir and rilpivirine. Boosted PI plus 3TC have also been shown to be efficacious. And there are other strategies that are being pursued now, like dolutegravir plus darunavir ritonavir, islatravir plus the doravirine, cabotegravir, and rilpivirine. And the good news is that the current guidelines, DHHS, EACS, European guidelines, and IS USA, include two drug regimens as an option for first line. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention.